forever. We were created to worship the King forever.
Father, we just bless you on tonight, oh God. We thank you for your presence in this place, oh God. You say where two or more gather, there you are in the midst, oh God. So we come before you, oh God, ready, oh God, with arms open, oh God, hearts expectant, oh God. We thank you for your presence in this place, oh God.
Yes,
it is
God.
Undeniable, oh God. It is so great, God. You're so magnificent, oh God.
Yes, Lord.
In all of our ways, we acknowledge you on tonight, oh God. And we say, be glorified. Be glorified in our praise.
Lord, yes,
be glorified
Lord.
In our worship. Be glorified in our talking to one another and everything that we would do on tonight. In the teaching and the preached word, oh God. Holy Spirit, let your giftings reveal themselves, oh God. Minister to the least of these, oh God, that will walk through the doors on tonight. And I pray that you would travel into the highways and the byways, oh God, into the life rooms that you would birth on the inside of people's homes, oh God. Minister like only you can, Holy Spirit.
Yes, Lord.
Speak like only you can,
yes,
Holy
Lord.
Spirit. God,
yes.
Heal and save and deliver like
yes,
only you
Lord.
Can, oh God. Lord, we pray for families on tonight, that you would mend broken hearts, oh God, that you would draw your people like only you can. When your name is lifted up, oh God, you promise to draw all to you, God, from the north, the east, the south, and the
yes,
west,
Lord.
Oh God. And so we call them forth, oh God. We say, hold not back, oh Lord. We pray, oh God. We pray for your harvest, Lord Jesus, that it would come forth, oh God. Lord, that you would have your way on tonight. Lord, be glorified. Be glorified. Lord, I pray for those who are hurting right now. I pray for those who are believing for healing. Let it be done on tonight. Let it take place on tonight. Through this time of worship, experiencing your presence, and in the preached word, oh God, save, heal, and deliver like only you can. And we'll be so careful to give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise, because you're so worthy. You're so worthy. You're Alpha. You're Omega. You're the beginning. You're the end. You're our friend. You're wonderful counselor. You're Jehovah Jireh. You're Yahweh, the living God. You're Emmanuel, God,
yes,
with
you
us.
Are.
Lord, you are holy. You are mighty.
Yes, you
You're awesome. Lord, you are
yes,
forever God.
God. Yes,
Creator,
Lord.
Oh God, you are
yes.
love. You
yes.
are love. You are eternal. And God, we just acknowledge you in all of our ways. God, words can't describe all that you are, but you are. You are the great I am. And in you, God, we say we live, we move, and we have our being. We
yes,
stand
God.
On holy ground in awe of you. We
in
have
awe.
The fear of God, Lord, but you are so great. And we just say, have your way, Lord Jesus. Have your way. 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 Have your way.
Yes, Lord.
Saying, I am the great I am. I am here. I am here. I am here for those who feel afar off. I am here. If you reach out to me, I am here. I
yes.
am here to meet you right
yes.
where you are. Right where you are. You may have
yes.
come broken, but I have come because I am the great I am.
Yes.
I am the great healer.
Yes.
I am the great mender. I mend up broken hearts. I mend up broken families. I mend up broken lives.
Yes, God.
I take the things that look shattered and I can put them back together again.
Thank you, Lord.
I can renew you. I can remake. I can create in you a clean heart. For I am the Lord and I change not and I am almighty.
Yes.
I am greater. I am greater than your circumstance.
Yes.
I am greater than where you are right
yes.
now in this life. I am greater than your problems. I am greater than your pain. I am.
Yes.
Almighty. I am the great I am.
Yes, God.
I am the great I am.
Thank you, Lord.
I am.
Hallelujah, God. Hallelujah, Jesus. You are. Now, Father, we just thank you, Lord. We honor you for your presence that's in this place. We thank you for your presence going all throughout the airways. From the sanctuary, God, I thank you for all the people that press their way out live on tonight. for Saturday Night Live, God. We applaud your presence, God. We honor and we bless you, God. King of kings and Lord of lords. Mighty God. Mighty God. Mighty God are you. We thank you, Lord, for gracing us with your healing flow, with your presence, with your love, your joy, your peace, your serenity. Thank you for the blood of Jesus that washes away all of our sins, all of our wrongdoings, God, all of our wrong thinking and wrong attitudes. Thank you for the blood that cleanses us. Your word says if we confess our sins, you're faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I thank you for every person under the sound of my voice that is in the sanctuary, that are in their homes, in their living rooms and family rooms and bedrooms, listen to their smartphones and tablets and TVs, God. Lord, you are bringing forth healing, deliverance, God, forgiveness and grace. God, you are freeing us from doubt and unbelief. And God, you are refreshing our faith in you. Thank you, God, for your presence. For in your presence is fullness of joy. Hallelujah, God. Hallelujah, God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Come on, give the praise team and the praise band, Ace and Leroy and Howard a hand. Glory to God. Good to see everyone on tonight. We're going to get right on into the word. Amen. Hallelujah. God is a good God. Glory to God. And I want to talk to you. We've been in the book of Ephesians. I want to thank you again for coming out tonight, joining us, pressing out. Those that are online, those are here in the sanctuary. Hey, you're going to get a treat tonight. Amen. God's going to meet us right where we are. Amen. And we're going to look for just God to just really speak to us and change us and move us out of our own way. Do you realize that sometimes we get in our own way with our rationalization, with our mindsets, when we don't understand what God is saying? Amen. But sometimes we just got to get out of the way and just go and flow with what God is doing. Amen. Well, I want to talk to you today about learning to walk in your greatness. Learning to walk in your greatness. We've been in the book of Ephesians. We've been in the book of Ephesians. We're on chapter 5, and we're talking about learning to walk in your greatness. God has a great plan for your life. Amen. And let's stand to our feet. We're going to open up in prayer. Open up in the reading of the word. Hallelujah. Stand to our feet, everybody. Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 through 3. Again, give the Ace and Howard and Leon a big hand clap for the praise. Just flowing with God. Come on, give them a big hand clap right quick. Amen. Thank God for them. Amen. But Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1. We'll be reading from 1 through 8. We'll be focused on 1 and 2. We're going to take some time on this and break it down. The natural, the engineer in me wants to go through it, but the teacher in me wants me to explain it and make sure that we have the understanding of what God is saying. Amen? Amen. So we're going to go to Ephesians chapter 5, verse 1. Turn to your neighbor. It's time to walk in your greatness. We're going to learn how to walk. We're going to learn how to walk. And we got the little baby up there because that represents us spiritually in God. Amen. And there's a joy of learning how to walk. But before we talk about that, let's get right into the word. Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 through 3. And you'll find these words. Read it with me, please. Imitate God, therefore, in everything you do, because you are his what? Dear children. Live a life filled with love, following the example of Christ. He loved us and offered himself as a sacrifice for us, a pleasing aroma to God. Let there be no sexual immorality, impurity, or greed among you. Such sins have no place amongst God's people. Let's keep going. Obscene stories, foolish talk, coarse jokes. These are not for you. Instead, let there be thankfulness to God. You can be sure that no immoral, impure, or greedy person will inherit the kingdom of Christ and of God. For the greedy person is an idolater, worshiping the things of this world. Don't be fooled by those who try to excuse these sins, for the anger of God will fall on all who disobey him. Don't participate in the things these people do. For once you were full of darkness, but now you have light from the Lord. So live as people of the light. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Read this. This is our foundational scripture for our church. And I want us to get this in our spirit. It says, this means that anyone who belongs to Christ, what? Has become a new person. The old life is gone. A new life has begun. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Pray with me, please. Father, we just thank you right now for your anointing that's in this place, Father. We thank you for your Holy Spirit. We welcome you to teach and to guide and to direct. Howard sits down. Holy Spirit, stand up. Speak to us like only you can. You have a way of speaking to each person online, in the sanctuary, like they're the only ones in the room. Would you do that for us today? Feed our souls. God, feed your people like only you can. Take this outline, take this study, and God, make it fresh manna from heaven. In Jesus' name, and in Jesus' name, and in Jesus' name, amen and amen. You may be seated if you can. We're talking about learning to walk in your greatness. And as I was preparing for this, and as God gave me this thing, because all throughout the scriptures, you're going to see five ways that God has shown us how we need to learn to walk in Christ, all in the book of Ephesians chapter 5. Amen? But I was thought about, I have four children, and I thought about two of my kids walked real early. They both walked early. I mean, all four of them walked early, but some were earlier, some were like between 9 and 10 months. They just started walking. And one thing is they would watch us. It was my kids that were the most observant that walked the quickest. And they watched everything that we did. They watched how they didn't even crawl. They went straight from the crib to walking, to standing to walking. And it was like they were always watching our feet. And when people came around, they were watching their feet. And then one day, next thing you know, they were standing up. And next thing you know, they were walking. And we're trying to like keep them from the steps and stuff like that. So guess what? But they were imitating what they saw. In this scripture here, Paul is talking to the church of Ephesus. He's encouraging them to imitate what you see. What you've seen in the word of what you heard about the Christ. Amen? Let's look at this in the Amplified Version. And I love the Amplified Version because it gives us several words for the Greek words, because several words have several meanings. Let's read the first part. Therefore, now when you see a therefore, you got to look at what it's therefore. That means we're going to have to go back and look and see what God said before, because he's moving us into something deeper, but it's based off of what he just taught us in verses 31 and 32 and 30 and 28 and 29. So go back and study that. I'm going to highlight 31 and 32. It says, therefore, become imitators of God, copy him, and follow his example. Capital H, that means Jesus. As well as beloved children, imitate their father. Now, in America, we have a taste of fatherlessness. So for some, they say, well, I didn't have my dad. Well, mom, mentor, learn how to walk, follow their life. And it goes on to say, and walk what? Continually. That's a present active tense. Imitate, that's present active. Love, continually in love. That is, value one another. Practice what? Empathy and compassion. And unselfishly seeking the rest, what? The best. Not the rest, but the best for others, trying to see if y'all listening. And just as Christ also loved you and gave himself up for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God, slain for you, so that it became what? A sweet fragrance. God wants us to lay it all down. Now the key, why I get the Amplified, you see in this full word for love in the Greek. You know, I can say in our American language, we have one word, we say, I love chocolate. I love my children. I love my car. I love to skate. We have all these things we love, but they don't mean the same thing. But in the Greek language, they had several words. They had storge, which represent a family love, a familial love. So in the sense of a father loving his son or a mother loving her daughter, it was a family love. Then you had phileo, which was a brotherly love. I love that brother over there. That's my bro. That's my homeboy. And then you had eros love. That's that lustful, desirous love, that burning love that really is seeking to get but is not really looking to give. It's passion. That eros love. You know, you may have eros love for chocolate. If you're in BC before Christ, you had eros love for that girlfriend or boyfriend, but you weren't really trying to add to them. You were taking away from them. And then last but not least, you had the agape love. That unconditional love. And that's what that scripture is talking about right there. The value one another. Practice empathy, compassion. Put yourself in that other person's shoes. Unselfishly seeking the best for others. See, Paul intended that these exhortations that he's given us in this book to guide us into the patterns of wise living. He wanted us to develop the following qualities in our Christian lives so we can look more like Christ. Now here Paul launches us to the highest standard possible. And this is the standard. Be imitators of God. It means to imitate him, to mimic. It means it's present tense continuous. It's an ongoing action that we're continually striving in to be more like Christ. But how can a finite human being imitate an infinite God? You know, as I read this, I'm remembering my dad, and I'm approaching his birthday, October 13th. He's transitioning to glory. But one of his prayer requests almost every week was, pray that I be more like Christ. If I go back and look something, I just go back and look at his envelopes. And everyone was like, pray that I be a Christ follower. Pray that I be more like him. And it's reassuring to know that in his golden years, 78, 79, he was striving to be more like the Christ. There was something in that. It's right there in Ephesians chapter 5. Understand this. If we are called to be God copiers, then what does a God copier look like? That's the question we have to ask. What does it look like to be a God copier? And what needs to be done to become that person shaped and formed in his image? Well, it takes surrender. It takes a yieldedness. It takes a dying to my way and rising to his way. Amen? How many know that's not always easy? How many know, let me say it this way, it is, but we don't make it easy. How many know it's real easy to yield? But something in human nature wants to be the boss. Are you with me? You know, you ever had somebody tell you something to do, and just because they told you, you didn't want to do it? You would have done it. It's like, if you hadn't told me, I would have done it. That's the nature of the flesh. That's rebellion. It's like, okay, I don't want to do it because you told me. There's an innate need in the human flesh of man that wants to be boss. Here's the news flash on 9/11, September 11th, 2021. You are not the boss. The beautiful thing about, as we memorial this day, And we honor all those all those that died in the Twin Towers, all those that rescued those in the Twin Towers, and some that gave their very life. They laid their lives down. On one day in America, one that was a day, I remember my wife was on a job at Coke, and she had prayer. And she had a prayer every morning on her job, but this prayer, I think she did a noonday prayer after the bombing, and everybody showed up for it. The executive showed up for it. And only it was like four or five people, but everybody wanted to pray because all of a sudden, their world was in shambles. I remember I couldn't get a hold of my wife. I was trying to call her because all the telephone lines were shut down, and I ran to La Petite to get both my sons from the daycare because I felt like we were losing control. I just wanted to see my children. Are you with me? But that day, when I think about 9/11, was the day that I learned that I had to be totally surrendered. Are you with me? So many uncertainties. So many things. And I saw the beautiful thing that I remember about the country is that Republican, Democratic, Green Party, everybody, Libertarian, they were turning to God and saying, Lord, bless our nation. Lord, don't let it be a crisis to get us back to the Christ. Help us to be more imitators. Lord, help us not to be continually so into the militarization of this nation going forth and dominating other countries. Help us, because then we wonder what we reap what we sow. Help us, Lord. But I digress. Let's go back to this. We learn how to be God copiers. And I see five things in this chapter 5. And we're going to go over one today and for the sake of time. But there's five we'll be covering in the next couple of weeks. We do it by learning to, one, walk in love. Everybody say walk in love. Secondly, we need to walk in purity. Everybody say walk in purity. Thirdly, we need to walk as light. Everybody say walk as light. Come on, at home, say it. I got to hear you now. Fourthly, we want to walk carefully. How many know it's important to walk carefully? Well, I say walk carefully. And then the last one, walk spirit-filled. Come on, say walk spirit-filled. Those are the five things. And it's in this passage that's glaring, saying, okay, I'm not only going to ask you to imitate God, but then I'm going to show you how to do it. Right in my word. Now, Paul starts by commanding and not suggesting that believers imitate God and how they treat one another. You say, well, I didn't see him talk about treating one another. Yes, you did. We saw him last week, right? It doesn't say that in the second part in verse 1, but it starts with the word therefore, so we got to look back to see what it's there for. And so when we go back to Ephesians chapter 4, verse 31 and 32 in the New Living Translation, it starts out by saying, get what? Get rid of. Who get rid of it? You get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, harsh words, and slander, as well as all types of evil behavior. Again, evil is living backwards. Backwards behavior. Evil behavior. God wants you to live and live a life more what? Abundantly. Instead, here's the thing. It says, okay, get rid of all this stuff. Take it off because we're putting on our authority. But then instead be what? Kind to each other. Tenderhearted. Forgiving one another. Just as God through Christ has forgiven you. Imitate God so you can do this. Imitate the Father so that you can have a horizontal loving relationship with your brothers and sisters. Let's look at this. Ephesians chapter 5 and 1. Amplified. It says, Therefore, become, present active, continually, imitators of God. Copy him and follow his example, as well as beloved children imitate their father. Now in 1820, Charles Caleb Colton coined the phrase, imitation is the sincerest form of flattery. Now, 3 John 11 says, beloved, do not imitate what is evil, but what is good. You say, yeah, I'm imitating, but no. God's saying, imitate what is good. He who does good is from what? God. But he who does evil has not seen God. It's so important to have that time of devotion on a daily basis. Why is it so important to have that? Because that's the time that you begin to commune with the Father and you see him. And that when you see him, he sees you. And you, no man can see God and live. As you begin to see God and for who he is in his character, in his love, in his peace, in his long-suffering, you begin to die to yourself on a daily basis. Are you with me? And so you come out more loving. If you're praying and you're not coming out more loving, you aren't praying. You need to evaluate and say, okay, how do I need to get fresh life into my prayer and devotion time? Are you with me? Maybe you need to get up and walk around. Maybe you may need to go out into the park and pray. Maybe you may, I don't know, maybe you need to climb Kennesaw Mountain and just have a time of communion. Maybe you need to get on your face. Cut off the phone, cut off the notifications, and cut off the TV, and cut off the praise and worship, and just get on your face and worship God. You say, well, Pastor, when I do that, I just fall asleep. Maybe you need to get some rest so you can appreciate the voice of God. How many know rest is anointed? Are you with me? Elijah, he put him to sleep. He was all depressed and anxious. And when he got ready to pray, he's like, Lord, I went and prophesied, put fire down from heaven. He just brought fire down from heaven. Went through a major depression, wanted to die, the scripture says. And God put him to sleep and woke him up and brought some food. Are you with me? By the ravens. Are you with me? Rest is anointed. Let's look at this a little bit deeper, what Paul was talking about when he's talking about imitators. The term imitator was understood by Paul's readers. Imitation was the main part of training of an orator. The teacher of rhetoric declared that the learning of oratory depended on three things. What are the three things? Theory. That means the philosophy, the mindset of what you learn. Let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus. Philosophy, theory, code of the kingdom. Blessed are those that mourn. Blessed are those that, are you with me? Those are the codes of the kingdom. Then imitation. Imitation, that means habits. Begin to develop godly habits that imitate the Father. Prayer, devotion, giving. Prayer, devotion, giving. God so loved the world that he gave. God gives and he forgives. Are y'all with me? You want to imitate God? God gives and he forgives. If you do not tap into forgiveness, then you're in a prison. You're in a prison, a self-made prison, because when you spend time with God, you learn to be forgiving. What's that? Thank you for giving me this experience. You've matured me to a new place in God. So God is a giving God and he's a forgiving God. Let me say that one more time. He's a giving God and he's a forgiving God. So I begin to imitate that, and so I begin to practice that. So when I practice a habit, I create a lifestyle, and when I create a lifestyle, I create a destiny or destination in God. Now let's look at Ephesians chapter 5. Thank you for pressing your way. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 2, Amplified Version. Let's look at this. It says, and walk. Now this is a continual thing, continually in love. That lets us know that it's a process. Everybody say it's a process. It's a continual process. It's not something that you do 1 hour and then you give up the next hour. It's something that you have to continually strive and work at and say, Lord, have your way through me. Amen? Continuing love, that is, value one another. That means I got to put a higher value on you than myself. Practice what? Empathy, feeling what others feel. And now that goes against everything in our society today where everything teaches us it's all about me. and compassion, and unselfishly seeking the best for others. Just as Christ also loved you and gave himself up to us, an offering and sacrifice to God, slain for you, so that it became a sweet, sweet fragrance. Amen? What does walking in love means in verse 2? Let's check this out. It says, it means to conduct one's life in a certain way or a certain lifestyle. See, we look like God the most when we give to him our very best. What are we saying? Give God the best version of yourself every day. We would have a revolution if the church began to give everyone the best version of themselves. Are y'all with me? What you are is God's gift to you. Let me say that again. What you are is God's gift to you. What you make of yourself is your gift to God. See, you're already a gift. And he's gifted you with so many things. But how you develop those tools that God's given you, amen, is what you're giving back to God. Amen? And know this, if he's called you to do something, he's giving you all the abilities and everything that you need to complete it. Amen? Now, the beauty of a journey is every step you take, not necessarily just getting to your final destination, but every step that you take to get to that place that you're trying to go as you go through the destination. And so many times in life, we get caught up of going, I got to get here, I got to get there, but we don't enjoy the journey. What do you mean, Pastor? On the way, we don't enjoy the little blessings that he gives us. Can I give you an example? As we were preparing for our last child to go to college, and we're trying to get all the paperwork and all the things in, there were little blessings that God kept dropping in. And the tendency in the natural is to go move on to the next big thing that you have to do so that we can produce what? Results. Because we're very result-oriented. And the Holy Ghost would say, hey, just dial it back and just praise him for that little scholarship that you got. And then another one would come up, and oh, we got to get this money done. And the Lord said, and God said, just praise him for coming. Then another scholarship would come. Are y'all with me? And breakthrough after breakthrough after breakthrough. Oh, we couldn't get a dorm. And it was like, oh, that's the next big thing. They'll pray and just give him some praise for what he's going to do. And then the dorm came through. Oh, let's go sign up. No, before we sign up, let's give God some praise. What are you talking about, Pastor? Maximizing the moment in God. We're in love with the outcome. People love the outcome, but we hate the process. We love the glory, but we hate the story. And so we love the testimony, but we hate the test. God loves the process, every step of the journey that it takes to get you where you need to be in God. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, I'm in process right now. I'm in process. I'm not what I'm going to be, but I'm not what I'm going to be, but I am going to get there in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm in process. And how many know that's all right? Amen. Let me give you another example of this. In our culture, we love to spend a lot of money on weddings and hardly anything on the marriage. How do you know this, Pastor? I know even when we're doing premarital counts, people say, how much is, they can be spending $10,000 on a wedding. How much is premarital count? $500. Oh, that's a lot of money. That's a lot of money, they would say, to invest in your marriage. And I'm thinking to myself, that's a little bit of money because you're dropping $10,000 for here, $5,000 for the DJ, $3,000 on liquor for some people. Are you with me? And you can't pay $500 for your spiritual growth. You see how we don't like process? We're planning for the event. If an average wedding in the U.S., according to August 2016, was $26,640. Then I'd love to see, this is what I would love to see. I would love to see couples spend $6,000 on a wedding and invest $20,000 into their marriage. Would you like to see that? Huh? Some in premarital counseling, some in couples retreats, some in marriage conferences and weekend getaways. Why is my marriage so messed up? My first question to the men and women that I encounter is, what have you invested in your marriage lately? Well, you know, we I bought her some roses. I bought her some, what? So that's the, okay, $20. What type of investment have you swept off her feet and said, let's just get away and pack her bag so she can't say no? Are y'all with me? What have you made some hot tub water for both of you and say, yeah, I don't want nothing from you. I just want you to relax. Have you gotten them a massage? Are y'all with me? What type of investment have you made into one another? Or plan a couple's massage where you both can relax and spend time together and talk through your times. Are y'all with me? Have you had those financial meetings together where you talk about your finances and how you're gonna move and shake in the next 3 to 5 years? As a team, what type of investment have you made in your marriage? You know what I always say, if the grass looks green on the other side, you're looking at their relationship and that relationship, this person and that person, it's time to water your grass. It's time to go back and invest and sow into the lawn that God has blessed you with. And that's the person, that's the life partner that God's blessed you with. Amen. Stop picking them apart and looking at, how many of the devil have you picking your spouse apart? Oh, they don't got this, they don't got that, they don't got this. And you know, and this what? I say it's the devil because, you know, this is how you know it's the devil. Because as you're doing that, you're not looking at yourself. You're so focused on them, you don't realize your imperfections. You'd be like, well, Pastor, I know I got some imperfections. No, you got a lot of imperfections. But because you're so focused on your partner, you can't see yourself. Everybody say self-evaluation. Holy Spirit, help me to see myself. Amen. We're in a hedonistic society now where everything is about me, mine, and I. And we have to take those steps back to see ourselves. Amen? Are y'all getting something out of this? John 13 and 35 in Amplified says, by this everyone will know that you are my disciples, by how much cornbread and chicken you make when you come to church, by how much money you got in your bank account, huh? By how much, you know, money you got in your retirement account, about how big your house is, how about what type of car? By this, everyone know that. How about if you drive a nice car, a Bentley or a Benz? Does it say that? It says, by this, everyone know that you are my disciple if you have love and unselfish concern for one another. Well, I think if we want to imitate God, let's look at the perfect example. It's laid out for us in Philippians chapter 2. Now, on your own, you can go back and read the Gospels, Mark, Matthew, Luke, and John, and look at the lifestyle of Jesus. Read to red. That means that's what he's saying, and get those words deep in your spirit. But for now, for the sake of time, we're going to look at Philippians chapter 2 and look at the encouragement of Paul to the church of Philippi for the church today. Amen? Let's look at this, and I'm closing. Are y'all getting something out of this? I hope so. Amen? It says this in Philippians chapter 2, verse 2. Then make me truly happy by agreeing half-heartedly. No, not half, wholeheartedly with each other. That means I got to give you the whole part of me. You know, something about us, we don't like giving the whole. Give me a little bit. Come on. Wholeheartedly with each other, loving one another and working together in one mind and one purpose. We're living in a society where people are taught to be so individual that we don't even know how to work together sometimes. People don't even want to be on a team. Team to most people means I get my way. Are you with me? Have you seen that? God wants to get us to a point where it's not my way, your way will be done. Amen. What would happen to the church if we put all of our egos down and begin to flow with the Spirit of God in a way where he gets the glory. Amen? Look at this next verse. Don't be what? Selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be what? Humble. Thinking of others as better than yourselves. Don't look out for your own interests, but what? Take an interest in others too. Almost finished. Look at this fifth verse. You must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had. That's the same scripture that says, let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus. Speaking of attitude, because your attitude will determine your what? Altitude. How high you go in God. Let's keep going. Sixth verse. Though he was God, he did not what? Think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges. Oh, if this is not a thing for our nation to see when you're talking about privilege and white supremacy. Jesus, if we follow his example, evangelical church, if we follow his example, Christians in the suburbs, blacks, white, and Asians that cannot identify with urban Americans in less fortunate situations, if we gave up our privileges like the Christ, that's what Christ did. He's from heaven. He came from heaven to earth to show the way. Remember that song? He came down, gave up his privilege. He took the humble position of a what? Slave, and was born as human being when he appeared in human form. He humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal death on a cross. One of the worst deaths. Crucifixion was like the electric chair back then. It was the death of a criminal. But aren't you glad it didn't stop there? This is the story before the glory. This is the process before the exaltation. We see this right here. Therefore, God is what? God is what? God is what? What does an elevator do? It takes you up. God has elevated him to the place of highest honor and gave him the name above all other names, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. I turn to your neighbor and say, that's everywhere. That's everywhere. Amen. If you didn't know that, on earth, in heaven, and under the earth, that's everywhere. And every tongue will declare that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. We must decrease. He must increase. We must learn to imitate him. When he was brought up before the Pharisees, he could have defended himself. He could have brought down fire. He could have taken himself off the cross. He walked in pure humility. You want to see what humility looks like? Look at his life. Don't compare yourself to the other person and what they're doing. What? Look at what God's called you to do and allow him to begin to move in you in ways that you've never seen. Let's stand to your feet, everybody. Father, we just thank you right now for every person under the sound of my voice. We thank you that your hand is here, your grace, your love, and your peace. I thank you, God, for each person that pressed their way to the sanctuary, online, whatever the press was. You know, some have to work tonight, some had to get their families together. You know the press that they had. But Lord, I pray that you would just change our hearts in the midst of our press and process. Change our hearts and make us more like you, God. We yield and we get rid of the anger, the bitterness, the wrong attitudes, the lying, the cheating. We lay that all down, God. The deception that would make us think that we need to stay in our own way and that we have to be in control. We relinquish control tonight. And we say, God, you be glorified. You be glorified. The truth is that, God, sometimes when we're not in control, it scares us. But Lord, you haven't given us a spirit of fear, You've given us a spirit of love and power and a sound mind. So in those times that you are demanding surrender, Lord, help us to move out of the way, to yield, and see the glory as we walk through the story. Help us, God. Give us insight. Help us to see the end from the beginning. God, I pray that you would touch all the marriages here on today. God, if there's anyone that feels like they've given up on their marriage or their relationships, I pray, God, whether in the sanctuary or online, I pray that you would meet them right where they are. Let them know, God, that this battle is not theirs, it's yours. And we surrender our marriages afresh to you this night. I lift up all our singles that are believing God for godly life partners, God. God, I thank you that you would keep them while they're single like only you can. And Lord, that you would raise up godly men and women for each and every single in this place that have a heart after you for those that desire to be married. In Jesus' name. Lord, I pray that, Lord, we would surrender our finances, our giving of ourselves, of our time, our talents, and our treasures. And Lord, our forgiving and releasing people when they hurt us and learning to do it quickly so that we're not carrying the baggage of past relationship hurts. We yield to your will, whether it be personal hurts, church hurts, we lay it all down on tonight. This September 11th, we lay it down, 2021, and we say, be glorified, be seen in us and through us, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, and in Jesus' name, amen and amen. Give God some praise, you all. Come on.
Hallelujah. Not by power, by your spirit, God. Send your spirit, God. Not by might, not by power, by your spirit, God. Send your spirit, God. Fire. We are the temple. We go by the fire. We are the temple. You are the voice. We are your song. You are God. We are your people. You are the light. We stand in awe. We stand in awe of you. Oh, we stand in awe of you. Oh, not by might, not by power, by your spirit, God. Send your spirit, God. Not by might, not by power, by your spirit, God. Send your spirit, God. You call us out of the darkness into your love, into your light. Grace upon grace, beauty for ashes. You come to us and we come alive. We stand in awe of you.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah.
We stand
come on.
In awe of you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Not by my
hallelujah, God.
Not by power, by your spirit, God. Send your spirit, God. Not by might, not by power, by your spirit, God. Send your spirit, God. By power, by your spirit, God, say your spirit, God, breathe, come and breathe on us, spirit, breathe, come and breathe
yes,
on us,
yes, God,
come and breathe,
yes, God.
Yes,
Lord. Hallelujah.
Spirit free.
Hallelujah, God. Thank you, God.
Come and breathe.
Yes, Lord.
On us.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, God.
Oh, we stand in awe of you. We stand in awe of you. We stand in awe. We stand in awe of you. We stand in awe of you. Oh, we stand in awe of you. By your spirit, God, send your spirit, God. Oh, we stand in awe of you. Stand in awe. Yes. Oh, bless you, bless you, bless you. Spirit breathe, Spirit breathe on us. Oh, breathe, come and breathe on us. Spirit breathe, Spirit breathe on us. Oh, breathe, come and breathe on us. Spirit, breathe, come and breathe on us. Oh, yes, breathe, yeah. Fill us with your breath. Oh, we stand in awe. sing it. Oh, oh, we stand in of you. We stand in awe of you. Oh, not by might, not by power, by your Spirit, God. Send your Spirit, God. Not by might, not by power, by your Spirit, God. Send your Spirit, God. Not by might, not by power, by your Spirit, God. Send your Spirit, God. Not by might, not by power, by your Spirit, God. Send your Spirit, God. We stand in awe of you. We stand in awe of you. We stand in awe of you. We thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord God, for being here with us tonight. Lord, we bless you. We thank you. You're faithful to us, Lord. Have your way. Do whatever you want to do in our lives, in our hearts, in our minds, Lord God, as the word comes forth tonight. We pray, Lord, may we be willing vessels, ready to receive of your word. Lord, empty us out so you can fill us up again. Lord, we ask right now for that great exchange where your love is poured out again in our lives, Lord God, fresh and new in Jesus' name. We ask you, Heavenly Father, to have your way. Lord, remove things that need to go. Lord, any idolatry, anything, Lord, false, any idols. We ask that you just clean us out, Lord God, that there be no barriers in the way of hearing your voice and of drawing close to you tonight. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Hallelujah be to your name, Lord. We stand in awe of you. Oh, we stand in awe of you. Oh, we stand in awe of you. We stand in awe of you. Lord, we just thank you. Lord, we thank you that it's all about you.
Say yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Fall on us. Start a new revival. Fire, fall on. new revival fire fall on us. We say yes, Lord. We say yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Oh, we walk in you.